interactive. We've got great presenters for their time to be here. But through my experience, starting as a young coach 30 years ago and being involved with my previous jobs at Bauer or whatnot, is that we're all hockey coaches. We all love the game, no matter what level you're at. If it's in the minor hockey, if it's at the junior B level, if it's the OHL level, if it's at the NHL level, we're all coaches. And it's funny because we all have the same goals is to be able to get our players to be able to get them better, and able to do that, we have to get stronger as coaches as well. And for myself, starting in minor hockey the way I went up, it's the same with Wes. You know, it's all about being able to communicate, be able to network with coaches, and maybe see what you like to do and what you've done in previous years. And you know, Dave Brown's here, general manager here. He gave me an opportunity to work with the Ice Dogs, which really got my MBA in coaching. Even though it was for 1 year, working with Mike McCart, Randy Lavisier, gave me an opportunity how things are done at that level, really, which kind of opened up my eyes, but even involved in minor hockey and being able just to talk to guys. And that's how I got better. We all have opportunities to go on to websites and find drills and things of that nature, which is great, and they're great tools. But my experience with minor hockey is being able to take those tools and be able to implement them and why we're doing that. And the best part is being able to talk to other people. Heck, I'm calling guys on the spot, just asking how they're doing things with their power plays or breakouts and things of that nature. And they're always, any coach, no matter who it is, they're always welcome to ask to call them and ask them questions that will help you out as you go forward. So having said that, it's great to be here. It's great to have Wes, who's, you know, kind of put this idea together, and to watch him grow as a coach and where he is. And you know, it's not coincident enough that he's in the OHL now, and he's going to go to greater things as years go on. But good job, Wes, putting this together with your group guys. Good work. Now, get to the presenters. Our first presenter is Ben Vanderklok. And Ben is the goaltending coach, as you all know, with the Western Conference champion Nashville Predators. A native of Welland, Ben is currently in his third season in his role with Nashville. Previously spent 5 years as assistant goaltending coach. In this position, his main responsibilities was with the Milwaukee Admirals of the AHL, as well as the Cincinnati Cyclones of the East Coast Hockey League. Prior to joining the Preds, he spent 6 seasons as head goaltending coach with us with the Niagara Ice Dogs, a lot of fun, Ben. And then also 2 years with Murray at Brock University. So at this time, let's give Ben a great welcome to the team.
Everybody good? Yeah. Well, when Wes asked me to speak, I said, sure, I'll speak. And you know, I said, how much time do I get? That we can spend the whole day on goal thing. He said, you have 45 minutes. So hopefully my computer holds up. I've had some glitches and whatnot. So hopefully we have no malfunctions as we go here. I actually thought it was not related to my computer. I got back here on Sunday. I started my summer camp. I had all kinds of little stuff put together for the little ankle biters, and my computer started messing up throughout the week. And I'm like, well, clearly it is my computer. I don't have our expert video guys to bail me out today. So hopefully it holds up. But when we were talking about what to speak about, you know, I figured the audience wouldn't just be goalie-specific people in the room, not just goalie coaches. We thought it'd be head coach, assistant coaches. A lot of the time, you know, those head coaches have responsibility of trying to pick a team, trying to pick based on tryouts. Assistant coaches take on the role of, you know, well, you take the goalies down one end for 10 minutes kind of thing, or you take the goalies for half the practice and whatnot. So I tried to come up with a topic that was, like I said, for an audience like yourselves that everybody could grab from it. So what I decided to speak on was what qualities to look for and develop, because they overlap. So for me, this very first slide, I heard this last year from John Cooper. I was sitting around the table. John Cooper's the head coach at Tampa Bay, and we were sitting around the table, and somebody asked him, he said, how have you had so much success from minor pros right up to the NHL? Every team you've been with, you've had really good success, whether you've won or not. He says, it's really simple. He says, the game is 80% goaltending. Until you don't have it, then it's 100%. And his point was that he had great goaltending everywhere he's been. So for us, I have 13 foundational points that I think is really important. You guys don't need to write all this down. I'd rather you listen to me than read this, but you guys will get a copy of this. We'll get it sent out to you. But for me, one of the hardest things to teach is processing. And even in the game of goal thing, it's a lot like players where you're literally watching a player. And I don't know how many times you guys be like, man, the guy sees the ice so well. He just sees it in slow motion. And we're the same. We believe you can learn it through video, through repetition, through the patterns of a game. But ultimately, some of the best guys, they just see the game in slow motion. They do things that are just special. They're unique. So the first one for us is the processing element. How well they connect the dots. How well do they anticipate the play? How well do they read the play? How do they process the stick blade, how it's going to propel the puck at the net if they're going to go low or high? How they're leaning on their stick, how they're holding their hands. All these things they're trying to pick up. You know, their opponent recognition. Yeah, everybody knows Phil Kessel, but how well can you take that information? If you studied Phil Kessel for the Stanley Cup final and in milliseconds recognize all the stuff that you studied and put it from your brain, or from your eyes to your brain to your limbs to react based on what you know about him. Things like tracking the puck, just simply tracking the puck off the stick plate. How well they can find pucks through traffic. The best guys just have a knack for finding pucks through traffic. We measure through visual training contrast sensitivity. We literally will bring in our prospects and measure contrast sensitivity, meaning how well can you find a black puck traveling at 85 miles an hour through black pants, black socks, black jerseys, things like that. And again, it's an element of processing. And for me, this is big. And when people think of mental toughness, it's so cliche. It's like, well, how good does he bounce, or how well does he bounce back after a bad game or a bad goal? Or maybe when it's player of the month, and we always say, well, with player of the month, it's like the kiss of death. You're almost like, yeah, it's great, it feels good, but you're going, uh-oh. Like, you know, guy bounces back, with a game that is below average because he starts to feel too good about himself. So that part of the mental toughness for me is 20%. It's critical. But when I think of mental toughness, 80% of it is this kind of stuff. It's how well you can think the game and how quickly you can think the game. So there's 13 points for me. This is the first one. When we watch some of these clips here, you'll see Crosby gets near the goal line. When we're watching these, just watch the goalies, all right? You'll see Bobrovsky recognize it. He processes it at a bad angle. And you see he gets into what we call a post overlay to make sure that there's no holes there. And again, he just recognizes Crosby gets exactly in that position. This one here, you'll see Bobrovsky, you see his right skate here is squared up to the puck. He's gonna realize that there's a guy all alone here. You'll see him kick this skate back. And again, it's a great example, just a good processing. He ends up getting over there, beating the pass because of that processing element. You see on this one, this puck gets delivered to the point. As you can see, it gets stopped here on a stick. A lot of guys would think that he's gonna backhand it or maybe just redirect it. He recognizes a guy wide open back door. He's almost borderline cheating on it, seeing this play develop, and a pretty tough play. You see this play actually happens, it plays out, and Yussi makes a heck of a save, all because of his processing on that play and recognizing it. This one here, Henrik typically plays with a conservative depth anyways, but this is a great example. He reads this rush, he sees this seams wide open, so he plays a little bit deeper. By playing a little bit deeper in this case, you'll see he comes over and he makes a really, really tough save look real easy. This one here, Pekka recognizes that Kessler's gonna get to the net front. He's one of the better guys in the league at the net front. And you'll see him take a step out. So if this puck did get tipped or redirected, there's gonna be no holes through him. And you see him recognize that. He completely takes that step out because he knows the situation and this guy being there in front of him. So just a great read, great processing. This one here, finding pucks through traffic. Again, just connecting the dots, having that knack to find that puck. He knows that he's gonna get delivered to the net. He doesn't see it completely and he finds it. Great one here, Tommy Pudnok, who used to play for the Ice Dogs. We talk about as soon as you see a guy's numbers, you can look up. So a great recognition that, bang, I got 1 second to look up, I see his numbers, you'll see him recognize this, and he makes a really routine save. But again, it's processing and recognizing that he has that opportunity to look up and find this puck. Great example here by Lundqvist, puck's in tight, he reads the stick plate, you can see with his shoulders he's taking what we call aerial angle away. If he actually stayed straight up in this position, that angle might be able to beat him over the shoulder, but because of where the puck positioned, he recognizes he's going to try and go up on him, and takes that aerial angle away by his shoulders, almost smothering with his shoulder, and he makes a heck of a save there on that play. Good processing, good tracking. Again, just a great way to measure your goalies. Do they actually track the puck? Do they watch it all the way? This was a big save for us at the time. We ended up tying this game late. Kevin Fiala scored an overtime, and that made the series 3-0 for us. And again, just good tracking. The next area for us is mobility. And when we talk about mobility, we want guys to play with speed, power, and quickness. It doesn't matter if they're going north, south, east, west. We want them to do everything with speed, power, and quickness. It doesn't matter if they're going from their feet to their feet, if they're going from their feet to their knees, if they're going from their knees to their feet, if they're recovering, staying down, knees to knees. We want them to be just as good, just as efficient, just as quick in all directions, in all situations. I invented this word, you'll never find it, but we say that a goaltender's positioning and angles and how he plays in terms of the positioning element is often linked to his mobility. If a guy can't skate, he's very limited. He's got to play deeper so he doesn't travel as much, so he doesn't get caught out too far, stuff like that. So I always say to the guys that if you're mobile, you're multi-dimensional. Like that or not? Meaning you can play with various depths and so forth. So mobility is huge for us. It also affects the puck handling. A lot of guys may think about puck handling, you know, they think about shooting the puck and making passes and being nifty with it. But a lot of it stems originally just from getting out to the puck. You got to get to the puck before you can do anything with it. But here's some just a good example. We'll watch Carey Price here, feet to feet, beating the pass on his feet, a long distance pass further out. We'll see Pekka do the exact same thing. He gets over in a hurry on his feet. Just great mobility on an east-west play in zone. This one here, feet to knees. You see how quick these guys can execute with the order. Again, great pass through a seam here. Bobrovsky getting over. Really good speed, really good power. You see here on this one, just recognizing that on this pass, he's a little bit deep. Based on where he caught this puck, he knows that he's got maybe a quarter of a second. He's got to get a step out. He's a smaller guy in the league. You'll see him take that step out. And again, just great mobility. And again, it's also linked to that processing element. All this stuff usually is. This one here, Carey Price is obviously one of the guys in the league that's real smooth. He makes things look easy, if you will, at times. You're going to see this play. It comes from here into the slot, back door. Pretty tough play. You're going to see how easy he makes it look. He goes from his knees to his feet and then back down on this play. And he gets some help from his defensive, but I think he would have made the save anyways based on how well he transitioned. This one here, on his feet, feet to feet, through a seam, you see Holtby again, just getting over. It's great mobility, and not just on their feet. Like I said, this whole sequence is great. Bobrovsky makes a save, pops back up, gets to the post, right back up, pass east-west, gets it on his feet, makes a good save, right back up. Again, really good mobility there. Lundqvist on this one, before this puck even hits the ice. So he's down here, it goes up, it kind of bobbles. Before it even hits the ice, he gets right back up into the position he wants to be in. And again, he gets right back down. So just really good examples there of the mobility that we're looking for in all different sequences. Positioning and angles. Again, it's linked to processing. Positioning is based almost always on a read. And the thing we hear a lot, especially with minor hockey, is, well, you should be in the white ice, get out of the blue ice. And again, we got a mixed audience, so it is a good message to send to a 7-year-old, because a lot of times they're back in and they're literally on the goal line and so forth. But positioning is based on a lot of different factors. And I put it here, it's a game of situations, it's not a game of shots. So it's not a situation where, well, the puck's here, so we need to stand there. It's the situation is this, so we need to stand here, or we need to slide here. And there's factors that are important in recognizing that. So I put here, knowing where to be in the net based on the specific scenario, the opponent's options, the puck positioning, a goaltender's size is a factor, his mobility or lack of mobility, his skills or lack of skills, all determine processing. Pekka Rinne plays completely different than UC Saros. One guy's not better than the next, but from a positional standpoint, it's totally different. They're completely different where they play and how they play, different situations. A lot of them are the same, and they do execute the same way, but there's a lot of situations they call for a different execution because of the style they play, the attributes they bring, their limitations, and all that stuff. So just some examples here, and like I said, more based on reads than anything. We'll see this puck squirt out. Schultz gets it. Then you see Bobrovsky, how far out he is. Why is he this far out? Because there's no pass option here. There's no rebound option. Even if it hits him and explodes off him, he's got a lot of help here. Every Pittsburgh guy is basically way above the dot, so he's going to take this step out. He makes a really good read, and it's great positioning on his part based on that. Carey Price on this one, I see it cross the keep here. He holds his ground, he doesn't back off. And again, a really, really good positioning for the exact situation. This one here, Colin Wilson kind of overtracks a little bit. Puck squirts out for a quick hit. Peck jumps out just to get the position that we're looking for. Philip Forsberg turns the puck over. And you see here, he'll take that step out. He doesn't stay where he is, he takes a step out. And at this point, it's going to take a pretty good move to beat him, and he doesn't have the time and space to make the move he needs to make to beat him. This one here, getting over on his feet to get into position. This one here, we call it center shifting. So what we talk about with this is gonna be a tip here. And a lot of times, especially with younger kids, we'll see him, because he's squared up to the puck carrier, he's gonna react by reaching with that leg, kicking that limb out sort of thing. But anytime there's a tip or a deflection, we wanna actually treat as if the shot's coming from here, even though it's happening like real, real quick. So what'll happen is, what we would be looking for is, we want Carey Price to shift over, put his body in line with this tip, and then there's no holes through him, so we go in what we call a closed butterfly. So his hands collapse, everything's in tight, and there's no holes through him no matter what. And it's great execution. Again, this is, for me, length of positioning. He positions himself perfect on this play, comes through, a tip gets made there, you can see he shifts over, and there's absolutely no holes through him. He makes the perfect save because of the, how he positioned on it. Bobrovsky on this one. Now, we just saw the first clip where he's literally almost to the bottom of the hash marks. Now he's killing the penalty, so you're gonna see he's gonna hang out on the blue ice the whole time. So he's hanging out on the blue ice, middle of the blue ice, right? So Kessel's got the puck, and you see his option. He's got an option here. He can deliver this puck on net, or he can maybe hit this guy here. So if Bobrovsky comes way out and this pass gets made, he's got no chance to get there, right? If he comes way out, he gives up a rebound, it's going over there, he's got no chance. If he gets shot out by Kessel, clearly he wouldn't be in the best position versus if he was way out, but we gotta respect all the options. And we have to anticipate that any of these things can happen. So I don't know how many times I would hear, not from our coaches in Nashville, but over the years, this guy's in the middle of the league, and if he scored, you go, why is he standing a foot off the goal line? Well, he can do this, he can do this, he can do this, there's lots of options. So again, just giving you an example of positioning is based on your reads and the situation. Kessel puts it right in his chest. This one here just gets outside, we call our dead angle. So as this puck gets outside this dead angle, he now has to, what we call, bump off the post. And again, just a great, great job positioning based on the situation. So he just gets outside that dead angle, so he won't be just bump off that post to make sure the positioning was exactly how he'd want. The fourth one for me is size. And we say the bigger the better. And here's why. We have a guy in Nashville that's, he's 6 foot, but so I'm not fully all in on gotta be huge. But there's some benefits to it if you have a choice to make and you say, man, this guy's really good, or this girl's really good, who am I gonna take? And the reason that size is preferred, we're gonna get into it. But I say you need skill 100% of the time, and you need size 20%, 15%, 25% based on the game. The obvious one is you got more net coverage. That's a no-brainer, right? So that's number one. The second one is he can play deeper in the net, allowing for less travel time on second chances or east-west plays. So for example, a guy that's 5'11", let's say a two-on-one for example, a puck carrier, a guy 5'11", probably has to come out further than a guy 6'5", to cover the net, right? So if that pass happens, or there's a rebound, now that guy 5'11 is further to travel on that situation that he has to travel east-west, right? So that's one reason. The other one is that he's got longer limbs in those scramble scenarios. If I go like this to Pecorine, I'm telling you his arms go this much further past mine. So when we get into scrambles, situations where he has to reach and extend his legs or extend his arms, he certainly has more wingspan or range than a guy less size than him. With puck handling, same thing. His torso is so much longer than mine. If we stand here and I say, Pex, reach with your stick as far as you can, he would go to the garbage can, I might go to Wes's foot. So we get more range with handling the puck. No different than a player of Chara, penalty killing, stick on puck, he just smothers you, right? He has the option to look over screens. Not that we only look over screens, because we gotta find the puck multiple ways, but he certainly has an advantage if you can say, well, you can also look over the screen, you don't just have to look around them. So again, it's an advantage there. It allows for what we call a greater torso shift. So if you think of being in a butterfly and the puck squirts out and you're trying to shift to take away, a puck that squirts out and smother with your hands, that torso can shift way more than a guy less size. So we talk about, like I said, a choice. Obviously, bigger is better than smaller. There was a time that the small guys were the fast guys and the big guys were the slow guys. The big guys now can move just as fast as the guys that are smaller. Having said that, I do believe in minor hockey, I believe in junior hockey, that it's gone a little bit out of control to an extent that it's at times I feel like it's like a prerequisite. Well, the guy's not this size, he has no chance. And then I feel that you're narrowing your field of choice, and there's people in that field that shouldn't even be in that field. And all of a sudden you're seeing guys that might be drafted or make it in, and you're like, these big, swole, clunky, heavy, and it's like, how'd you ever pick this guy? Well, he's 6'2", and you know, maybe we can get him to move. Well, you know, so I do think it's getting carried away. So again, don't take it out of context that I'm all for size, because we have one of, if not the smallest goalie in the NHL, and I love him, and I think he's got a bright future. But again, just when you're talking about, you know, choices and advantages and whatnot, it's certainly an advantage. Clips in just his examples. Pex makes this save here. Piggy makes this save because of his size. He's huge. Just one here, we talk about that range. You know, he's 6'5", he can get across with that blocker. Just a good example there of size. We talk about this in shootouts all the time, and one of the responsibilities that I have is our shootouts in Nashville. So anytime we're playing a smaller goalie, don't let this one out, but we talk about this being an option, and it's not ever an option on a bigger guy. So we call this kind of a hard deep, where you really take it to the far post, stop and cut back sort of thing, you know. But on the bigger guys, we don't even really talk about it being an option, because they got that range, that wingspan, the reach back. The smaller guys, when we get into the Rantas and that, we use that as a pretty good example. We want guys that are feisty, guys that battle, compete, high energy, all the time. That competitiveness is critical. That feistiness is critical. We want guys that hold their ground and battle, and no matter what, are doing everything in their power to keep the puck out. When I say that, don't mix that up for being busy. You don't want guys that are busy, sloppy, diving all over the place. You still need order, but there's a difference between being feisty and really being competitive, and in those situations where you got to be in the top end speed and whatnot, you bring that. When you think of guys like Carey Price and Crawford and Bobrovsky, yeah, they're very controlled, but don't mistake it for that competitive, feisty battle that they bring. And it's often linked to a guy's work ethic. Guys that you can find in practice. You can see if they play out pucks. You can see if they play out rebounds. You can see if they care that the guy's tapping the puck in the empty net while they're just, you know, getting up for the next shot. So I think it's one of those things that you certainly can measure in practice. And then when you see it in practice, what speed are they doing it with? And do they sustain the whole practice and things like that? So when I talk about feistiness, here's some good examples here. I love this clip of Bobrovsky. He ends up kind of tripping himself all over. Watch how quick he gets up and battles to regain position. This is being feisty. That's what I mean by feisty, just bringing that juice. This one here gets tipped, so Pex gets to extend a little bit. And yeah, he might be reaching, but at this point, like, he's got to be feisty. He's got to hold his ground no matter what, finding that puck and making that save. This one here, he gets a little bit sloppy because he loses it. But at that point, you've got to be feisty. You've got to keep the puck out no matter what. This puck's going to get delivered wide, intentional wide tip. And Yussi's got to hold his ground. He's got to battle. He's got guys jamming. Got sticks in his five hole. This one's a really good example here. Pekka gets bumped by Joe Thornton, but he actually gets pushed in by Salamaki. And I don't know if this would get overturned, but Pekka certainly can't make that decision at the time. So you see he kind of gets bumped, and you see what's going on here and what's going on here. And he's got to battle to get to this puck. And you'll see he gets feisty, finds it, gets out there, makes a good save. And again, it's just 100% just based on his feistiness and will to make that save. Next area that we would recommend, as I said, looking for and developing is the ability to recover. And when you talk about recoveries, goaltenders have less than a second to recognize what's going to happen. Sometimes you're recovering off of a save. Sometimes you're recovering off a wide shot. Sometimes you're recovering off a broken play where it hits a shin pad in front of you and squirts out to your right. So there's three stages of recoveries that we talk about. The first stage is urgent, and urgent is when we have time. It's our most desired way. We use techniques called foot placement recoveries. We use shimmies, we spin recoveries, we shift with our body. It's the most desired manner. It's the most desired position we want to be in, because that's how we have our best net coverage. It's going to give us the best opportunity to make the next save. Maybe a shot comes through, you get up to your feet real quick, you're set, and you're ready for the next play. The second stage is desperate. And desperate often happens when you think it's urgent, and all of a sudden you hit the puck, and I realize it's on Murray's foot there, and I go, oh crap. And in those situations, guys have the same order, they're just not as desired, it's not as much desired techniques. Guys make way too many saves in those environments for it to be by accident. Think about the guys like Jonathan Quick, the Pekka Rinnes, Dominic Hasek in his era. they had order in those situations. And again, it's a situation where you realize, you go, oh shoot, I got desperate here. So we use a different techniques called pad reach, wide dive, paddle pokes, a stack, glove smother, butt rotation, all right? And the last stage is whatever it takes. And obviously whatever it takes, sometimes it doesn't matter how pretty it is or what you're thinking, you just gotta find a way to make it safe. There's usually once a game where it's just a matter of whatever it takes. The hardest thing to do, and the hardest thing to teach, and the most important thing, is recognizing what stage it's at. When Carey Price first came into the league, a lot of people thought he didn't try, and he didn't compete, and it didn't look like he was giving all his all. But the reality is, for me anyways, without knowing him personally, I thought he just got stuck in the urgent stage a little bit. He'd make a save, the rebound would be there, and he'd go to lift and push and be in the net. And then, you know, Pekka, for example, with us, we talk a lot about trying to, sometimes he overuse this desperate stage at times. Sometimes the rebound's there and he can get over there in a more desired way, a power push. He thinks it's a little further along and maybe gets a little bit sporadic going for that puck, right? And one guy's not better than the next. What has to happen is, like I said, in less than a second, recognizing what stage it's in. Because you certainly don't want to be desperate and reaching, because you've got holes when you can get there in a more desired way. You don't want to be getting there in a nice, perfect, pretty butterfly slide when the puck's going to be getting tapped into an open net. You need to get over there and get to it. So here's some examples of those stages. The first one, just urgent. You'll see this puck just gets sifted through here. And just Pekka just recognizing, get up to his feet where the puck is, get back to his feet, and then right back down. Just realizing that it's an urgent scenario. This one here is what we call a short distance power push. So it's a short distance. Carey Price lifts his foot and he pushes over and gets a good seal. And this next one's the exact same thing, but a long distance. You'll see it's puck squirts out. He's got time. He just pushes over. Obviously, he's got great net coverage by doing so, and he takes it away. These are short shimmies. You see this puck just is off center a little bit. So Pekka doesn't want to lift his right leg and push over because then he's going to be open up. So he just literally does what we call a shimmy. Some people call it a knee shuffle. He shuffles over just to recenter a little bit to get his body there. This one here, this is a tough play. Layered offense is always tough for us goalies because you don't know who's going to get the puck. You got to respect both. So this puck goes through the seam and he thinks it's going here, so he's going to commit and end up going to the second layer, and he gets into what we call a long shimmy. So this puck squirts through and you see Pekka shimmy and shimmy and shimmy and on his knees, and he makes a pretty good save. In desperation scenarios, we always talk about sealing the ice first. We build from the ice up. So when we watch these, you'll see that they take the ice away. In some cases, they'll get the glove over the pad. But again, sealing the ice, building from the ice up. And you see these situations that they're not in urgent stages. This puck, pretty quick hit here. And he's got to take that ice away and seal it with a pad reach. Same thing here. Pretty quick play. That was a big save at the time. UC does a great job here. Yeah, I'd love it if he could have his body over here and be in a full butterfly, but it's a quick play and things happen. So he's got to take the ice away. He's got to try and get his glove above his pad, which he does, and he does it, makes a really good save. Again, more in a desperation scenario. Carey Price on this one decides to go for the poke, misses it. Well, you've got to have, you still got to make a save. Now what are you going to do? He can't push over. He can't get his body over. So he seals the ice, gets his glove above the pad, he builds from the ice up. He does a really good job. A couple more examples. You see here what we call a glove smother, where you know your body's not going to get there, so you try and smother him with your glove, trying to take that aerial angle away. This one here, glove smother, like Pekka, squirts out on him, it gets tipped. He picks it up late again, smothering with his hand. This next one, he did the exact same thing to his blocker side. And again, there's a situation where he can't get his body over there. He can't get into perfect positioning, but still having great order and decisions. Wide dive back on the Y here. This one we call our flipper saver. We're caught out of position, almost use your pads like a pinball machine. You kick that flipper out just to take the ice away. And we work on all these things. We don't perfect roll, we're not in them too often, but these are the saves that make a difference. Everybody makes the saves they should make, at least at our level for the most part, or you guys see it on TV and you get ridiculed and you hear all about it on the panel or whatnot. But for the most part, those are the ones that make a difference. I'm just gonna let these roll. These are pretty awesome. These are just some whatever it takes. And again, I could say that we work on this stuff, but I'd be lying. See a little barrel roll here, puck gets away from them. And again, it's not always pretty, but we gotta keep the puck going. One here pulling off the goal. I love Vermette. This one, this is good stuff here. This one, obviously Pekka should never have gone for the pole. But then what do? You just say, oops, I made a mistake. No, you gotta play, you gotta find a way, you gotta battle. This was huge. You guys hopefully saw this one. It's game three of the playoffs. They had the save. This was a big save. They actually, they're the finished version. I don't know if you guys saw the finished version. I called that. If you guys saw it online or not, but it was pretty neat hearing the guy. It sounded like a soccer fan. It's calling the game-winning goal in the World Cup or something. Outstanding rebound control is critical. So we always say that the ultimate goal when a guy shoots a puck is one and done. In a perfect world, we keep it all the time. So we got different techniques that we use. We use shifting, center shifting, you trap it on your body. You would sink so it doesn't explode up, you know, sinking down a little bit. We encourage big time with using your hands. I'm all for reaching across your body and catching a puck. I'm all for reaching in front of you and catching a puck. Not at the expense of reaching across and getting scored on, but you have a blocker for a reason, right? But certainly, I believe if you have it, it's better than if you're in the corner and the defenseman's going to get killed, or maybe there's going to be zone time. At least if we have it, we can make the choice whether to play it or not. We use an advanced skill called pad angling to determine where the puck's going to ricochet off our pads. And then the second phase would be putting the puck in a safe area. Obviously, the stick is the best tool to control pucks on the ice. Getting pucks into the corners or over the glass, stuff like that. Well, I wanted to just mention this point, too, especially with the coaches in the room. One of the other things that we work a lot on and we talk a lot about, and it's tough with the modern way we're playing bad angle stuff, which we use what we call reverse VH in a lot of situations or post overlay. We talk a lot about preventing bad angle shots to become good angle rebounds. And I don't know, I can't speak for the coaches here, but it's always, the message is always, put the puck in the net, something good can happen. Bad angle, put it in his feet, you know. Maybe that attempt leads to a second chance. Maybe it leads to zone time. Maybe it leads to a power play. Maybe it leads to a face-off, you run a face-off play. So we're big on really, really trying to track and eliminate those bad angle shots that are literally shots that you're just hoping you make a mistake to turn into good angle rebounds that lead to those situations that I mentioned. So I didn't put any of them in here, but this is just a good example. You see Bobrovsky here. He shifts on this puck, so he takes in the center of his body. We call that center shifting. This one here, Holtby traps it on his chest. Good example. Pekka will trap this one on his pad. We'll see Bobrovsky on this one. You see how he sinks down in his butterfly to make sure he controls it. I love the Pekka Rinne scoop here, scooping pucks off the ice to make sure there's no rebound coming off him. We'll see UC crossbody catch a knuckle puck. Right, I see him reaching down, I'm all for that. Instead of making a blocker, say, put in the corner. But again, not at the expense of giving up a goal or a rebound. This was the pad angling one I'm talking about. So you can see Zuccarello is wide open, back door. We're gonna be in a second here. So Price goes down, and you see how his pads are now. This puck would hit his pads, end up somewhere over here. And you gotta think it'd be dangerous. But you see him just kick that pad out just that little bit. And again, that's a pretty advanced skill. So he keeps the puck in front of him with that pad angling instead. I think I'm about halfway. You guys are still awake, I'm gonna put you to sleep.
We're good.
Okay. I think we're about halfway. I don't know what number we're on now, but traffic. Again, I feel like a lot of it's linked to the processing element. I kind of use the example, when you get in the car after a game and you're driving home, and I'm driving home myself, I hate it nothing more than when I get in the car, we lost the game, say 5-3, or whatever. Maybe we won the game 4-3. And I get in the car and I say, man, like, they couldn't do anything about those goals because all three of them, we couldn't see them, you know? And I think it's important to recognize that you more often want to get in that car and say, I don't know how he found those pucks through traffic. Those two saves he made, I don't know how he saw them. The best guys have a knack for finding those pucks through traffic. And there's certainly ways that we try and find pucks through traffic and try and find sight lines and change your sight lines and things like that. But the best guys know where to look. They know when to change their sight line and try and look for it somewhere else. They do an unbelievable job at connecting the dots before the shot. So before that puck gets released, they can recognize that a clear lane. Is there tip options? Is somebody going to be coming and screening me once the shot's being released? And we're talking milliseconds you have to recognize those things. How well they connect the dots when the puck's mid-flight. So maybe as they see the release, a guy cuts in front of them, they lose it, but they remember and recognize in milliseconds where that puck was released off the stick plate so they know where it's going to actually meet the net. And the best guys can do that. Maybe they recognize when the pups be in mid-flight, some new options after the release. All of a sudden, after the release, they realize that somebody that was below the goal line, they maybe didn't know he was there. All of a sudden, the puck's being released, they see the peripheral vision. Oh man, now I gotta control this puck with this guy off of my left post. The best guys have a knack for that. Best guys have a knack for locating the puck after the release. Sometimes you lose the initial release, it's just the way it is. But picking that puck up, and the best guys, like I said, have that knack. And again, I mentioned the contrast recognition, finding pucks through dark colored things. And you know, sometimes you might hear from a goalie, well, that arena, it's hard to see the puck because the seats, and it is. But again, the best guys can seem to get through that without any problems. So just some good examples here, just finding those pucks through traffic. This one here, like Kowalski, I can't even see him. I see his right pad a little bit. We'll see if here, he actually gets literally to the edge of the house, and not only does he stop the puck, but he actually makes a save. He reacts, he makes a save, he's tracking down on it. Just an unbelievable save that, again, just finding it through traffic. Peck on this one. You can see the sight line that he's looking. He's looking around the right side, I think it's Upshaw. This puck here is going to get delivered to the left side, and he makes this look so easy. He just does a little shift, so he reads the release, he shifts over on it. Obviously, he's going to lose it mid-flight because he's going through that screen, and he finds that puck. This one here, Carey Price, he's finding it. You see, great job finding this sight line. By getting this sight line with all these guys in front, he finds this sight line. You can see that the pass happens, and he gets over, and a grade A chance, he makes it look easy. Back on this one, Corey Perry in front of him, he's looking over the right shoulder. He can tell Yarncroft's in this shooting lane, so he knows this puck's coming to this side. And again, he probably doesn't see the release, but he can connect the dots on the way in. We'll see him just shift over just a little bit. He makes, like I said, a really, really tough screen and make it look really easy. When we talk about screens, we work on screens, or you guys might work on screens, a lot of the time it's when a guy's standing in front of you. That's only like a very small percentage. I shouldn't say a small percentage. I don't know. I've never looked at the number, but it's a portion of the traffic we have. Typically, the guys standing in front of you is when you're killing penalties, right? The hardest traffic is the moving stuff, and that's what happens all the time. The guy's driving through, your defenseman's trying to box out, he rolls off him, puck goes east-west, there's a guy in the middle of the lane, and you're losing pucks. You have 10 guys inside the zone. The puck works around the perimeter. You think about five guys inside the zone of your team, five on their team, that's 10 guys. You work the puck around the perimeter, the puck is being passed through 10 bodies, right, in terms of a sight line. So it's tough to find that puck. So this one here, just an example, Carey Price, he sees this puck to begin with, and he loses it. Obviously, you see the puck here, it's mid-flight, he's going to lose it, but he just kind of, he's got that knack to position, be tight, be calm. I'm not going to spend too much time on technique, because we can spend 3 days on technique. I think technique's the easiest thing to teach. But we do say that there's no bad saves, there's just bad save selections. There's certain times when you need execution to be done 10 out of 10 times the exact same way. Our young guy, Yussi, you're late. There's times with our young guy, Yussi Sorrow said, he'd be somebody we consider very technically sound. And I say to Jason, my assistant here, I said, be awesome if Yussi can come to the goalie school and teach these little guys exactly how we want them to be from a technical standpoint. But the reality is, if there's a situation that I would expect them to do something a certain way, usually with him, I can say 10 out of 10 times I know exactly what he's going to do and he's going to execute pretty well. So there's a time and a place when your technique has to be there. And again, we can't just start picking out techniques. That's a whole different presentation on its own. But I did want to just point this one out that, a proper technique allows you to make the save in the most efficient format, the most precise way, with the most net coverage, with the best ability to recover, the best ability to control the shot, and the best ability to give yourself a chance and ensure the save. So, like I said, there's a lot of situations, there's a right way to do it, there's sloppiness if you don't do it the right way, and again, it's all about making sure we give ourselves the best chance to do the things I just mentioned there. I just put some examples in here, just a technique. You see Beckett, he's got to be tight on this play. He can't have any holes. You just see good execution in terms of being tight and closing those holes on 2-2. We'll see here, this one here, Bobrovsky, in this case, he gets in there. This is a dead angle. We got this guy off of the back post. I think it's Hainsey. So he needs to be in a reverse VH so that if this guy shoots it, he can make this save. If this pass or rebound comes through, it allows him to recover. It's just perfect textbook execution for the goalie guys that are in the room on this play.
where he's patient on the shot, he gets himself in perfect position to get across on that one. So just a good example of a strong technique there. You see on this one, this puck actually ended up hitting Yarncroft's skate, squirts out here, and you can see he's gonna be on like the wrong line to start. We need him to recognize as he's coming out here that this puck's actually gonna be over here more. So he's gonna lift his right leg and put himself on a way better line. And again, from a technical standpoint, his foot placement was bang on, exactly what we'd be looking for to adjust on that. Little confined space breakaway, Beck is tight, controlled. And again, just from a technical standpoint, we'll see here, he's patient, he closed up his five hole, his hands are in tight, there's no holes, no pucks gonna get through. And just again, just good execution. Little east west, quick hit, good technique there. Beck on this one, he sees basically caught a little bit deep. He didn't play it perfect, but at this point, he has to bump off this post, get some depth, get square, all while staying down and tight. You'll see him here, he bumps off, he's tight, no holes through him, and again, he puts himself from a technical standpoint, just really good execution. Yeah, we can spend tons of time on that. Athleticism. People say athleticism is like the most overused word in sports, and I've heard it talked in particular. It's like, well, what's athletic? Why do you say he's athletic? Because he's busy, because he's rolling around all over the ice and somebody else is playing calm and controlled. For me, athleticism is the ability to put your body in awkward positions, the ability to contort to the ice, the ability to melt to the ice, the ability to have elite hand-eye coordination, those kinds of things. For me, big, clunky, awkward, slow, non-bendy is not a recipe for success. I want guys that can, like I said, they can do the splits, they can reach past their toes from the splits, they can put their body in positions that feel and look uncomfortable watching them do it. They can, when they go into the post, they literally melt into the post, so they're melting into the ice. It's not this rigid, clunky, stiff look, all right? So for me, that's what athleticism is in regards to the position that we play. So just some examples of what I mean. Just, again, and just being able to do that, having a guy fall on top of you, see here, like, that's being athletic, being able to make saves like that. Carey Price on this one puts himself in a position. He's in a full split here. And then the best part, he goes into what we call a scorpion. He thinks this puck's going to get elevated. Watch this, what we call, like I said, a scorpion. He actually lifts his right leg from a split position. That's athletic. That's what I mean by athletic. Maybe somebody else might have a different definition, but for me, that's what it is. UC, backdoor, big save here. Beck getting backdoor. The big man being able to put his body in those positions. This one, he tries to play it calm and controlled. He's got him. He realizes at this point, uh-oh. But again, he literally forces him out of not even taking a shot because of his athleticism. This one here, you'll see it hit Ekholm. This one is gonna hit Ekholm's shin pad. And it's literally hitting his shin pad going in the net. Becca sees it. And again, just putting his body in an awkward position to kick out that puck. And for me, that's what we call, that's athleticism. And then again, I just put one clip in just showing some hand-eye coordination, picking that puck out there in this battle. Almost there. Control. When we're looking for control and we're trying to measure it or evaluate it and then trying to teach it, we have two elements of it. The first one is body control. What I mean by body control is your body working in sync. Everything should work together. If I'm moving to my right, my left should be working with me. If I'm gonna make a blocker save, my glove shouldn't be going this way. Everything should be in position, in control. I use the example of, when you're watching like that diving or gymnastics or synchronized swimmer, everything is in sync. And we should be the same until we get into like those desperate situations and the whatever it takes situation that we talked about with recovery. So, in a perfect world, the body should be working together. Because even from like a physics standpoint, if I'm moving to my right side or I'm recovering, if I'm twisting like this to recover rather than just using my leg and lifting to push and things like that, you're going to take away from your ability to recover at the speed we need to recover. So not just for net coverage purposes, but from physics to get the push and get the power and get the speed and get out of the gate as quick as we want or get on the right line. The other part of it is positional control. And when we think about positional control, we think more of staying inside the post lines, not getting outside your parameters, not chasing, not getting caught out too far on the original shot so you can't get back on a rebound. So some examples of these guys here, this one's pretty routine, but just show up back here, he's recovered quick to his feet, his hands, everything's in place,
no big deal there. This one here, this buck's in behind it. You see Peckett, it's going back and forth, but how much he's in control. Everything's working together. His limbs are all working together. Carey Price here, this buck squirts out. You see there's no busyness. He's waiting. He makes it look really easy. Very controlled with his limbs. Positional control. This buck ends up getting tipped here and going back door. UC doesn't get caught out far. He doesn't get outside the post. And again, this is a tough broken play. It hits his stick, it squirts out, and he goes exactly on the right line. Again, to the post, the puck ends up at a dead angle, and it allows him, again, because of his positional control, to be in the position we would want. This one here, same thing. Doesn't get out too far. At this point, he gets himself right back in the post before anybody even touches the puck. Back on this one, kind of shows both. So he's got good positional control. You see his hands in place, his gloves still in position on this recovery, and he gets over from a positional standpoint and, like I said, from his body control standpoint. So a good example there. Puck handling, obviously, for maybe some of you guys in the room, maybe it's not as much of a factor, but it's certainly one of the top 13 things that we have on our list. And for us, there's two objectives in the game. The first one, the puck gets dumped in, we want to disrupt the other team's forecheck. Because obviously when the team's dumping the puck in, unless it's the change, they're dumping it in as a forecheck. Obviously they probably wanted to carry the puck in or chip the puck in, but they ended up going with dumping the puck in because they were getting closed off to us. So we want to disrupt their forecheck. And then the second part is we want to help our team transition as possible, as quickly as possible, sort of. So that's the ultimate goal for us. And our goal is we want them to make smart, efficient, accurate plays, not overdoing it, but the more skilled they are with the puck, the more you can utilize it, the more you can use it to your advantage. So I'll show you some examples, but the better they can be with the puck, the better it is. So we'll see Beckett, he gets this puck up off the glass. If you can get the puck up off the glass, you can bypass this guy. Some guys can't. Even in the NHL, they can't get it up on the glass. We'll see this play here. See Beckett point here? So he points a little bit to Jackman, and watch Detroit's players. They're all going this way. And they don't completely commit that way, and they're out of the play. But it's enough for him to reverse this puck, and we're going to break that clean just because of that quick play. Being able to get back on pucks, like being aggressive, stop these pucks. They're up on the glass. We encourage our guys to stop pucks on the glass in most buildings. Just getting back, and again, it's an element of puck handling, stopping those rims. Getting back and stopping is critical. That goal can now make a play on his own. It's just a simple, quick, direct pass. This was a huge play for us. We went down and scored. This was a big goal. Game two, Harry's older chuck. It all starts with literally a simple breakout play. This ends up in a goal as well. So caught him on a change a little bit. And again, Fisher goes down and scores. And also with Buck, and like, you know, from the other team's standpoint of their penalty kill, if you have a guy that can handle the puck, the other team will automatically leave that guy out there, and he's got a hold, not change, because there's always that threat that goalie might fire the puck up off the ice. So just from that standpoint alone, it has an advantage. Might be able to catch one player out there a little bit long on the PK sort of thing. And this is last, but certainly not least for us, and it should be for everybody, is having good people. And ultimately, you know, you need to have good people, guys that have a great work ethic. I always say, you know, I don't coach goalies, I coach people. And when a goalie comes through our organization, or even prior to me getting to Nashville when I was with the Ice Dogs and Brock University, you want a guy to leave your program, whether it's 1 year in minor hockey or in the NHL, whether he plays for us for 10 years or 1 year or in the minors. I ultimately hope that at the end of the year, when we shake hands, that he says, I'm a better goalie and I'm a better person. And that's ultimately my goal, you know, to dummy down what my goal is every year with the guys. That is my goal. And in a perfect world, you want to find guys that strive to do more, not less. Guys that leave no stone unturned that it might impact their development. Obviously, the accountability factor. And I always say, this is cliche, but skill is the only big player so far. It's hard to drill home to some young kid that is certainly really high skilled. It's 11 years old or 12 years old. But like, and even like more so to the way the game's going. If you talk to some of these older guys, the Mike Fishers and the Pekka Renees, and they're like, man, like you can't do what you did before, you know, because these young guys coming up work so hard, they do all the right things, you know, from what they put in their body, to what they do at nutritional, what they do in nutrition, what they do in the gym, what they do in the off season for skills training, and endurance training, and strength training, and how regimented they are in their sleep patterns so that they maximize their opportunity. There's so much information. So more so now than ever before, because you can probably always find that one player going, well, he didn't work, he was a lazy dog and got there. It's going away more now than ever, so skills certainly can only take guys so far. And then this is just my last point here, this is, well, I love this quote here, that we are what we repeatedly do. Excellence, therefore, is not an act, but a habit. And I think that speaks the truth. So appreciate it. I don't know how long that was. Hopefully, I didn't go too long. But appreciate you guys coming. Appreciate the opportunity. You guys will get this from Wes, the slide portion of it. But certainly, I'll leave my email and phone number. Don't ever hesitate to ask. As Frank and Wes said, we're here to educate. We're here to information share and learn, and I'm at the rink all day every day, so you're not bothering me at all. It's just what we do, so don't hesitate to reach out and give me a call if you have specific questions. Or
those files, are you gonna send the
we'll send it like in a PowerPoint. Yeah, okay. I have the slides separate from the video, so we'll make sure we get those.
Can you fire any of the videos through as well, or are they gonna be
video? I could if you guys are requesting it, but it will take some time. It takes some help from our experts.
Just a couple things about.